Good morning. Thanks for making it so early in the morning. If you're wondering why this topic is so long as a title, I would want to tell you that real-time monitoring and incident response is what we were all looking for, and it has to be done very quick because when the attack is happening, you have to respond very quickly. So we need to work on a smaller set of data. That is what I mean by security content metadata model. And we need to have a efficient search methodology so that we can quickly respond to incidents that are happening. So I am Preeti Subramanian. I am from Bangalore, India, officially known as Bengaluru. I work as a software architect at SecPod Technologies. I need a small favor. Who has not visited India anytime? Can you please raise your hand? Okay, and who have visited anytime? You can raise. Okay, I just wanted to understand if you can, you know, understand what I'm speaking. So just wanted to make sure. There's some people who didn't raise, so I'll try to speak slowly so that you can understand. So this is the roadmap of what you would be expecting in another 25 minutes that I speak. What are the current issues that are there in the data sets used by security products? And what are the standards such as SCAP? We'll try to quickly go through that. And then I would be talking about what is this metadata model. And now that we have this metadata model, how are we going to use it? And also an example to show real-time monitoring and threat intelligence. So there are two questions. The first one is why there is a lack or commonality between the data sets of different products that we use in our organization. There are different products that you must be using as patch management, intrusion detection, and all these products. But there is no commonality between the data sets that are currently existing. And why don't these products talk together and work like a single system? So, for example, if 90% of the attacks make use of a vulnerability, a known vulnerability, or a misconfiguration, you know, why not relate that and try to, when an attack happens, why not fix that? You know, attack might as well fix the vulnerability that is there so that no more attacks happen. So, how about, you know, making all this together and work like a single system? So that's where SCAP came into being. It's Security Content Automation Protocol. It is a set of open standards that are there, and it has flourished because of the community ideas that were there. And it's still maturing. And first, I will go through the enumeration that are there. I'll just quickly go through them. There is something called CPE, Common Platform Enumeration, where all the products, applications, hardware, operating system, everything is given a nomenclature, a name, and there is something called CVE. All the vulnerabilities that are there are enumerated and given an ID, and it has a lot of information. And CCE is a configuration enumeration, common configuration that you would find. And CWE are the common weaknesses that are there. They are categorized, and every CVE falls under some of the weakness that is existing. Then there are languages, OVL, or Open Vulnerability Assessment Language. That is a way to detect the vulnerabilities that are there in your system. And there is XCCDF. This is actually benchmarking the security posture. You must be having policies. So that's what it tries to check using OVL. So there are checks that are done. And anything that cannot be done automatically, you have an interactive language called OSIL that people like security administrators can actually answer a questionnaire. And like, for example, what is the serial number of your, you know, some device? If they have to enter it manually, then we can go ahead and check. And metrics, we always measure. So CVSS, it's the Common Vulnerability Severity Score that is given. It is depending on the access and what is the impact, integrity impact, confidentiality impact, and those things. CCSS, not very common. It's the configuration severity score, because every organization has their own way to measure configuration metrics. So we cannot have a common number that you can give to all organizations. It will depend from organization to organization. Yeah. And reporting, we have asset reporting format, and we also have asset identification. These are commonly used for reporting purposes, and integrity is a trust model that we have. Because we have this content, we add some digital signature, make sure it is integrity is maintained. So that's what SCAP is in a nutshell. And there is threat intelligence. There are a lot of malware, hundred thousands of malware, but we cannot give an ID to it, because then it will become very huge. So we characterize it and classify it as MAEC, and we mark it under those categories. And cyber observables is all the events that are happening in your system are marked as it is something like a registry that is created or a file that is deleted. All these events are understood by cyber observables. And structured threat intelligence sticks, all the threat information is structured in this. They are all expressed in the form of XML. And the exchange for exchanging the threat intelligence, we have Taxi. So all this is XML, huge, huge XML. So what we have a sea of data. If you have worked in XML before, if it becomes bulky and becomes very difficult to actually, parse it and then try to understand it, so it becomes a very big data. So that's why there is need for a metadata that you retrieve from all this, these single SCAP entities that we have. We take what we want, and it should be extendable in the sense that if something changes in all these standards, a little bit of change that comes, we should be easily be able to incorporate it in our metadata. So we store it as key value pair. You can store it in a big data architecture. It will be very easy to store all this information. I'll quickly go through this. I don't know if it is really visible, but it's ID, description. I store certain information, ID, description, the date if I want to have queries on date. So I have chosen to have date. And there are properties where we have a key value. So every CV has some properties, OVAL has some properties. So we store it as a property key and a value for it. So here is an example of metadata of the CV. We have the ID, description, and we have the created and modified date. Okay, but we have an important thing called score, because it's very high here, it's 10.0. And we have access vector, impact vector, all this is calculated. So we store this data, it's publicly available, so we store this data in a metadata format. So when we store this data, we can easily search. So if I say I want to know the recent threats that are there in the current world right now, so I just search for recent threats. So any modification or creation that has happened recently, you will be able to know those CVs. So when you click on one of them, it gives you the entire information, the tabular format that I've shown two slides before. That will come here on the search interface, and you can actually read about it. There are also references to external links so that you can go deeper and read about it. And different SCAP entities can be related. So for example, here we have a CVE. It is related to some of the products, that is Adobe Flash Player here. And how to check if this is existing, we have OVAL checks that you can actually click and you can execute that and try to see if you have those CVEs. And it also, every CV has a CWA weakness enumeration that it is associated with. So that also you can go ahead and research on. So how do we use this metadata? I have stored all this information, so what? I have stored all this information, and what will I do with this? So I have a sea of data, as I told, OVAL, XCDF, CV, all this information. I take the relevant information. CV also has how to exploit and how to fix. All those information are also there. But if I'm not really wanting to search on that, so I can like exclude those things and have a sea of data here. And the SCAP entities, I can just put it in the metadata, whatever I need. Then there is something called system info that we, there are multiple machines that are there in your organization. You can get all the information of those system, and you can, these are the actual facts that are there, and sea of data is what is actually you can check on. So you can feed that to the metadata, and this metadata, when it goes to the correlation engine, it can actually you know, respond quickly, because it knows that there is some file that is there, and you know that file is malicious, so you can actually go ahead and remove it. Or if you have a product which is vulnerable, you can go ahead and remediate that. So the flow of incident response would be, you collect all the data, all the events that are happening, the events that you are interested in, like you have ports, processes, files, registries that you want to read. And then not all events are, you know, important. Some just happen. There are like millions of them that happens. So the incident identification, any suspicious activity that happens, you feel that it is suspicious because the administrator has written some rules, or you know that this is not, you know, kind of what we would expect, like some strange exe starts running and you identify it as suspicious. So you feed it to the analytics and you correlation engine, and you try to see that this product, okay, it is vulnerable. So what is the remediation for this? So you go ahead and fix, and you can prevent attacks that are happening in your system. So this is an example of real-time threat monitoring. So for example, there is some EXE that ran. Here I've named it as injadbe.exe. It can be any name you think of it. And then it runs with a PID. Okay, and we identify it's of an Adobe product, for example, just taking an example. So when this runs and you know that this PID is of an Adobe product, you try to send this information, try to understand that this product is vulnerable because its version, vendor has released a patch and we might not have patched our systems. So we have identified there's a vulnerability, and okay, we can delete that file, we can delete whatever the malware has done, but that is not going to stop another attack from happening. So the best thing would be to also fix the vulnerability that is there so that other attacks do not happen. So we fix the vulnerability as well. So there is something called CRE, which is a common remediation enumeration. That is not very common, but we have remediation for all the vulnerabilities right now that we are searching. Our product is searching for vulnerabilities, so we also check the remediation. If it is not applied, we apply. So a remediation is identified, so you apply that patch and fix your machine. Okay, so there's a demo that I can show. Okay, this is our repository where we can search whatever you would be interested in. So for example, this is something called NERC compliance that I have searched. It gives me a list of XCDF that you can, you know, go ahead and download and you know, check if your organization is compliant. So this is one of the examples. I just did this to save time. So this is, I'm interested in all those Adobe CVEs whose severity score is more than 8, because I really want to go ahead and fix them as quickly as possible. So you can search for it and you can see if any of your machines have it. CVs which have access complexity high. So that also you can go ahead and, you know, search. I'm trying to search Adobe Flash Player vulnerabilities that are there. For example, I click on one of the vulnerability that is there. I know how to check it because I have Oval, which can go ahead and check if you have that vulnerability. That is on the right-hand side bottom. So it tells me all those eight signatures that I can check. We call it definitions. And also, what is the remediation? So since it is affecting Windows and Linux, so I will go ahead and check what is the remediation that is required for this. So it says that it has the product and the platform, and this is the patch that has to be applied. And the size of the patch, you can prioritize it. If it is a very big patch that you have to apply, you can choose it to do it, you know, a later point of time when, you know, probably your organization is free, you know, not in the working hours or something like that. So yeah, so this is there. And if you apply this patch, it solves 408 vulnerabilities, which is not a joke. So it fixes all those vulnerabilities. This is the Heartbleed, which became very famous because of the media. So yeah, Heartbleed, it is an OpenSSL. So you can see this is for the product OpenSSL. And you can check, you can apply, you know, these definitions. If you have an interpreter or you're running some Oval interpreter, you can run it. And you can see if it is vulnerable. And so if it is vulnerable, many products only tell you that they are vulnerable, but they do not tell you how to fix it. So here is the information how to fix it. So you can choose whatever is relevant for you and, you know, fix those. So if you search for some famous vulnerabilities that are there, Ghost vulnerability or Freak vulnerability, so you can go ahead and, you know, see all those information and try to fix it. So this is that, it's all working on the metadata. It's very small, so we are able to search quick. And all this I'm showing as a part of the demo, but this all can be automated, and you can actually go ahead and get the fix for it, and you need not go through like manually searching. You can write beautiful programs to just, you know, go and fix the problem. And this is from the host, what information has come. So as an administrator, you can see that information, vulnerability information, what compliance issues you have, and what all products you have installed, and what sort of operating system you're running. All those information can also be fed. This is the system info part that I was talking about in the earlier thing. So these are the actual facts that are there, and there are the information, so you can relate both of them. So if there is any attack that is happening right now, you will know there is something running in your organization. So you can identify it immediately. You can try to fix it so that it comes to near zero. So I did it pretty quickly. So I'm open to questions if you have any. Yeah, there is an agent, but this is only about the metadata, so I didn't show the agent how it is running. So imagine that you have some mechanism to get the system information and you can give it to the administrator. Those are the actual facts that are happening in your organization. You can correlate that to all the other data that is there. Right now I have shown SCAP, but there are other standards, so you can relate them. Yes. 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 We have a free product that anybody can use. It's called Saner that I had given a demo in the arsenal yesterday. So you can use this. It will fix for personal use. You can just fix the vulnerabilities that are there. There is definitely a missing piece of anti-malware. It is complementary to that because nobody can stop you from clicking anything on the site. And so when that happens, we need to identify that it's a, you know, a wrong file or something getting downloaded. So we need to fix it. So that can be related with this metadata. So the threat intelligence and the vulnerability intelligence all put together can fix the. Yes, yes, we have thought about it, and we are coming with a product in the end of the year. So this will fix that missing piece where we can maybe you know, integrate it with VirusTotal and to get the information for threat intelligence, because the information is there already, so we need not create it. So yeah, we can use that and integrate this.
How up to date is the database?
How? It happens every day. So for vulnerabilities, what do we do is we take it from the publicly available site that is there. So we don't actually research on the vulnerabilities, but if there is something that we find, we surely give a contribution. But we take it from something called National Vulnerability Database, NVD. We take it from there, but the oval checks that we have to do to find out the vulnerability, that we write as a research team. And we do it thrice a week, release thrice a week.
Can you do like every 12 hours?
Yeah, we can do that. Generally, right now we are running every 24 hours. So we can do that, yeah. Any other question? We are using, okay, if you have to exchange the information, this metadata information across the repositories, we give it in the form of JSON or XML that you can, you know, take it from us and you can probably integrate to your, you know, repository if you have, or else you can directly read it from us. So we have some sort of a RESTful APIs that we have. You can just download that content from our repository. Some of the content like checks and XCCDF and all this are only given to paid users, but you can openly check all the metadata. Metadata is totally free. You can just take it from our scaprepo.com and you can read it. Yes, yes, we are using MongoDB. MongoDB, Tenjin, yeah. Right now, we have not faced it yet, the scalability issues, but definitely it is. So the thing is, we are having powerful servers right now, so that way we don't see a problem. And to find out information, we run agents, so they all happen parallelly. So that also we are not bothered much about. It's only about storing this information and trying to relate it, which all depends also on the rules that are written by the administrator, because every administrator will have their own set of rules that they want to evaluate it on, and we are trying to, you know, understand the scenario right now. because we don't have the threat intelligence yet. So we will see how we are going to do this.
So how do you design this for petabyte scales or exabyte scales, or what's your fundamental idea or architecture at the bottom?
Okay, so the data is definitely going to grow because there are a lot of vulnerabilities that are going to be done. We need to store all that information because we cannot say that any CVE which is there older than 2007, we will remove it, because those are getting used, you know, very old vulnerabilities are getting exploited, which are not fixed because they are just ignored. So we are going to store all that information. We are not going to do that. But right now, yeah, it's GBs of data. Right now it is like that. And maybe move to TBs, but not sure. Maybe, yeah. But we will store all the information because it's necessary. Right now, no. We do not have an agentless solution because we feel that the way an agent actually goes and tests the machine is like more appropriate. Like it can go deeper and try to, because it runs locally, so it can do more checks. So that's how we want to go about it with the agent. So, any more questions? You can actually, if you have any questions, you can even write to me. I'll be happy to respond. So, if you have any questions of how to use this metadata, or if you have some arguments like why at all we need such a big data. Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.